It is 9 o'clock, time to conduct the business of the Wayne County Board of Commissioners for February the 4th, 2014. We'd like for everyone that has their cell phones or whatever, put them on the, either cut them off or put them on silent mode. Have our invocation by Mr. Ed Camardi.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we come today asking for divine guidance, that we perform the duties that we have been entrusted by the people of Wayne County. We pray that all items brought before us today shall cause us to be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath, thereby producing worthy results. Also, dear God, we pray for the continued great work of our Sheriff Department as they protect our county and serve all citizens as was done in the past. We ask a special blessing for all present today in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Stand and place the flag, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And again, I want to thank everyone for being here today. We've got a lot of business to take care of today and some very special business. First thing, Madam Clerk, you've got the video ready. We've got about a 2-minute presentation for our late Honorable Sheriff Kerry Winders.
May God bless and keep you always. May your wishes all come true. May you always do for others. Let others do for you. May you build a ladder to the sky. Climb on every rung and may you stay. Forever young.
May you grow up to be righteous. May you grow up to be true. May you always know the truth and see the light surrounding you.
May you always be courageous. Stand upright and be strong. And may you stay. Forever young.
Forever young.
Forever young.
Forever young.
May you stay forever.
May your always be busy. May your feet always be swift. May you have a strong foundation when the winds of changes shift.
May your heart always be joyful. Your song always be sung. And may you stay.
Y'all, thank you for the staff for putting that together for us. Have a resolution to read honoring Sheriff Kerry Winders. And then after I read it, we'd like to present it to Teresa and the girls. Hope I can be as strong as Major Greenfield was Friday to read this. If I have to pause for a minute, just excuse me. Resolution honoring the life and service of Wayne County Sheriff Kerry A. Winders. Whereas Sheriff Kerry A. Winders was a fine man who, with great character, high morals, and humility, led Wayne County Sheriff's Office, and whereas as a man representing the people of Wayne County, he served with leadership, honesty, integrity, dedication, loyalty, fairness, friendliness, respect, and a host of other values that brought pride to the citizens of Wayne County. Whereas Wayne County has lost a true soldier against crime as well as a friend. And whereas the world has better because of his service and dedication. And whereas even before his election to the office of High Sheriff in 1994, Kerry A. Winders served the citizens of Goldsboro and Wayne County as a police officer and detective. And whereas Sheriff Kerry A. Winders' smile on his face brought laughter, joy to those allowed to honor and work him for within him. And whereas he touched the lives of many throughout the county and the state by his many acts of generosity, selfishness, and kindness. And whereas, as a strong Christian man, Sheriff Kerry A. Winders led his life with principles of God first, family, then service to his community. And whereas his life work has touched countless people, will be remembered for generations to come. And whereas the broad vision, leadership, dedication, commitment, and excellence that Sheriff Kerry A. Winders brought to the citizens and leadership of Wayne County will be sorely missed. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Wayne County Board of Commissioners, along with the citizens of Wayne County, honor the dedicated service of Sheriff Kerry A. Winders and significant impact he made upon Wayne County, adopted this day, the 4th day of February, 2014.
Mr. Chairman, I move for adoption.
I have a motion on the floor. Any comments?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Daugherty.
I wish to make one change, if I might ask, and that is, in paragraph where it says, whereas he touched the lives of many throughout the county and the state by his many acts of generosity, where it states selfishness, that should be unselfishness. So I ask that we make that one change.
Any other comments?
Selfishness.
The word is correct.
The what's correct?
The word that's in here is
it
correct.
It is worded correctly?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Very well.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else?
Selflessness.
Selflessness. I'm sorry.
If not, I would like to, Teresa,
would you like to vote on that?
I told you I'd get emotional. I have a motion on the floor. If there's no other discussion, all in favor, show a sign of right hand. I would like to present it to Teresa and the girls. Before we move on with conducting the business of the county, Mr. Commissioner John Bell has something he would like to say.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, you know, the sheriff was very passionate about trying to get a new detention center built, and he and I was working on it, so at this time I would like to put a motion on the floor. When we do build this detention center, that we name it the Carrie A. Wendler's Detention Center. Sheriff Carey, one of the detention center.
I have a motion on the floor. Any discussion? No discussion. All in favor, show a sign of right hand. Thank you, Mr. Bell. Teresa, you and the family, if you know, stay as long as you like. But we know you have other things to do. If you need to leave, we certainly understand. But thank you. Thank you so much for coming. Down to business. Mr. Mayo, Appointment Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If you would turn in your agenda package to appointments that's in the front of the package this time. The first appointment we have this morning is a reappointment. The Wayne County Adult Care Home Community Advisory Committee. Alan Bullock. We'd like to make a reappointment at this time for another 3-year term. I'd like to put that in the form of a motion, Mr. Chairman.
A motion on the floor. Any discussion? No discussion. All in favor of the motion, show your sign of right hand. Motion carries.
If you will turn the page to the next, the Wayne County Board of Health. This is an appointment. The appointment committee is recommending Anthony Willett, who's an optometrist, to serve on the Wayne County Board of Health. And this is an appointment, and that's in the form of a motion, Mr. Chairman.
I have a motion on the floor. Any discussion? No discussion. Show sign of right hand. Motion carries.
Mr. Chairman, that's all the appointments we have at this time today.
Thank you, Mr. Mayo. Board of Commissioners, committee reports. Mr. Bell.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. my report is in the form of an announcement. We had a meeting with Gateway last week, special call meeting, and Gateway has some major problems over there that she's trying to reorganize the whole system. So what we have suggested and going to recommend that the city, the county, and the Gateway Board get together and try to formulate a ongoing plan for the Gateway can operate solidly. So sometime in the near future, we're going to ask for those three boards to meet and make some decision, some major decision as to how it's going to operate. That's all I have. And we also have a little bit of information about the detention center. Instead of me giving it, I'm going to ask Ms. Woods to come up and just kind of update us on what she has.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm here to talk to you today about the feasibility study that we did back in December. The request for qualifications were sent out on October the 2nd. They were sent out to 15 firms. We received 7 proposals from architectural firms in North Carolina, South Carolina, and Florida. We interviewed all 7 firms in two days, one on December the 2nd, some on December the 2nd, and some on December the 5th. The Board of Commissioners drafted a letter to the Secretary of Department of Correction on January 24th. Once we hear back from them, from the Department of Correction, on whether we will receive the facility, then the staff will recommend an award to the advisory board. And that's where we are at this point. I have contacted all of the architectural firms to let them know we are in a hold pattern for right now, but I am updating them as we get notice. So that's where we are at this point in time. Do you have any questions?
Mr. Chairman,
just a
question. So I'm understanding we're on hold waiting a decision from the state as to whether or not we will have access to the property.
That is correct.
Well, I see Representative Jimmy Dixon in the audience, and so, Mr. Dixon, we are kind of waiting.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Noel. Mr. Pate.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Not a lot going on because of the weather and all the sad events that have taken place, but did have a few meetings. Met at Waynesboro Monday the 27th, and pretty got updates on what their their events that they're having out there. They're moving as quickly as they can to try to have revenue events that bring money to the old Waynesboro. And so we talked about Piggin Park, Hillbilly Hike, Bluegrass Festival, and New Year's Day Hike. And so that's pretty much what happened out there. DSS meeting on Monday. Wayne County's DSS has been recognized by the state of actually, as bad as the NC Fast has been, they're being recognized as a role model in terms of what they're doing with NC Fast. We all know there's problems across the state, but I'm glad to say that our staff is doing what they're supposed to be doing, and they're being recognized. The hard launch for NC Fast has been moved once again to past. It was going to be January 21st. You can see that day's already come and gone, so that didn't happen. So the state is moving, working together, trying to get everybody in the state back on track before there are any kind of federal sanctions against North Carolina. Talked about guardianship, it's increasing in the county. And let's see what else we had there. And maybe I can ask Mr. Milford Smith, there was something that came up at our meeting about the water leaks on the boarding building. Are we moving on that or on the roof?
Boarding building?
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll talk to you about that later. Then. How about that? That's what they gave me in this report anyway, and I didn't know anything about that. But it was one thing that did come up too. The NC Fast is having problems, but NC Tracks is having equal problems. They had a young child that was allowed to go to a doctor for an office visit, had asthma real bad, and the NC Tracks would pay for that, but it would not pay for the pharmacy bill. So the county had to step in and pick that up. We can't continue to do that because it's very expensive to the county. So I encourage the state to work on that as well. Finally, tourism meeting. When you came up in an elevator out there today, you probably saw the poster in the back with the jet there, and then recognizing Seymour Johnson. That came from the tourism boards. So, and I thought that was very impressive. And these tax collections appear to be consistent with the last 2 years and should exceed $600,000 for this past year. And that's all I have today. Thank you.
Mr. Martin.
I have a couple of items. One, I'd like to speak to the Mount Olive Airport. I attended that meeting last week. It may not have been last week since our last board meeting. And I have our town manager, just like to recognize him just for a moment, raise his hand, Mr. Charles Brown. That's a very energetic airport board in Mount Olive. They are, I find them very concerned for economic development for the southern end of Wayne County, but for the area. And so they're very passionate about that. And I believe that sometime later this morning, Mr. Brown will be making a presentation related to that airport. One other very important item in Mount Olive is this work on the library, and I've asked Mr. Milford to give us an update on that at this time. And I see Ms. Phillips is here also, library director. She'd like to have something to say. She's welcome to.
Take me just a second to load my technology here.
That's why I asked you to do this, Milford. I had a little technology up here that I didn't want to mess with myself.
While Milford is loading his technology, we are running just a few minutes late. We have got a work session scheduled for 9:30 and 10:30, but please bear with us. We got a couple of more items that we really need to take care of before we go into those work sessions. We'll get to them just as quick as we can.
That's why I'm a building guy, not a computer guy. First, let me say that the snow and ice last week didn't delay the project as much as a lot of things because we had inside work they could do. Our change order for the decking that had to be replaced on the roof is complete. All the wall frame is done. The rough ends are done in the walls. We're shooting for an inspection this coming Thursday. Everything going as planned. We'll start hanging sheetrock as soon as we get an inspection. The cabinet elevations have been approved. Work has begun. So the millwork is in fabrication. Exterior masonry work is scheduled to start the second week of February, and a sample panel was installed and approved the week of January 14th. All aluminum window frames are installed, and glass will be installed this week. And that's the key ingredient here because once we get the glass in, we can start drying the building out. Right now, it's really cold in there. Steel building sweats, keeps the floor wet. We're looking for our drop inlet from the city any day now for our storm drains. All the exterior site rough ends, electrical lighting, landscape lighting, start the week of February the 25th. And I say all this to say that we're still on schedule. Now, but the Farmer's Almanac calls for another snow in February. So. Now, if I can queue up my technology here.
Milford, if you'll just wait just a moment.
You want the video to play is what you want?
Yes. Yeah, it's in there.
Okay. Did you guys unplug it? Any mouse control?
I think my fault.
Well, you're the first to use this new technology.
Yeah. Commissioner Payne, I know what you're talking about, and Mr. Parker was kind enough to send me a little note here.
Communication is good.
Those two offices on the first floor, we've decided to discontinue using them because every time we have a water leak in the mechanical room, the water floods that office and there's no way to prevent it. So rather than keep replacing carpet and, you know, there's a danger in there, mold and mildew, it's going to empty the offices.
Yeah, of course, their concern was having to move social workers together in a confidentiality when they're working. And I told them that we had a facility plan that will be going forward, so.
Okay. Yeah, there's no way to prevent it. It's going to flood every time we have a leak. The pictures, if we ever get them playing, aren't going to show you a lot except walls, you know, rough ends. But there's one picture that I do want you to pay particular attention to. From the very onset of this committee, Donna and the other committee members wanted natural light. We heard that a lot, and it's a good thing. And while that might sound like a simple task, it really isn't because of the new energy code. It really restricts how much fenestrations you can have in a building. And fenestrations is a fancy word for doors and windows. So to get the natural light that we needed or wanted, would have meant coming up with a lot more insulation to satisfy our envelope efficiency. But our brick system that we're using makes use of a 2-inch thick foam panel behind the brick that the brick actually fastened into. The system has been in use all across the country, not here because we didn't have that same energy code to comply with.
Mr. Camardi, we're going to have to come back to this because we've got.
I know, and just to thank you, Milford, we'll get back to it. But just for everybody's sake, I have on my smartphone, which is a lot smarter than I am, I'll describe to you. There's a building sitting there, and there's a man on a backhoe, and he's constantly moving dirt. That was of yesterday. So the work is going on, and this technology is smarter than we are. But just to back up what he said, it's progressing smoothly. Thank you,
Mr. Keene, Mr. Mayo, Mr. Daugherty, could we hold y'all's comments?
Mine's short.
Go ahead, Mr. Keene.
I've spent a lot of time this last couple of weeks, like we all have, and working our schedules. And as I prepared for my committee reports this morning, all I could think about was that the residents of Wayne County are in a time of trial. Kerry Winders, who served and protected his hometown and home county for over 30 years, first as a Goldsboro police officer and the past 20 years as Wayne County Sheriff, was shockingly taken from us. The bitter cold that we spoke about this morning has engulfed our county much of the winter. Last week was accompanied by snow and ice. The storm could easily have paralyzed our county and cost the lives of Wayne County citizens, were it not for the dedicated, highly competent staff of the Wayne County government, the Wayne County Volunteer Fire Departments, the Wayne County Department of Health and Human Services, North Carolina Highway Patrol, the North Carolina Department of Transportation, and with broken hearts, the Sheriff's Department. As with everyone else, the professionals desire to be with their loved ones in such times to assure their safety and comfort, but they brave the hardest of elements and struggle through ache and fatigue to assure our safety and to improve conditions so that we can carry on our lives. These times of trial brought out the very best in the best of us. And with faith, love, determined perseverance, we're a stronger Wayne County because of it. While some of it may be warranted, we are in a time nationally and locally of rampant disrespect for public officials and public servants. Mr. Chairman and fellow commissioners, may we take just this morning and exalt those who serve us in the worst of times. And thank God for calling these special brothers and sisters to public service, and ask our entire county, all the citizens of this great county, to join together and embrace these men and women who give so much while asking for so little. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. King. Mr. Mayor, 3 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I only had one meeting that was very special to my heart, and it was on January the 23rd. We had the base council meeting out at Langtree, and of course, that was reports from the city and the county and to Seymour Johnson as to the progress and what we have for the future. But that was a very special time for me and several other commissioners that were had the privilege of sitting at the same table with Sheriff Wendez. And we sat and had our usual conversations like we always do, and we reminisced, he and I did, and several of us, about how we grew up, being in the tobacco field. So we were sitting there having a what we would call a normal day. Little did we know that the following day, on Friday the 24th, that Sheriff Kerry Wendez would be taken to his heavenly home. That was a special time as I look back, sitting at that table at Langtree. The memorial service for Kerry Wendez on January 31st was very appropriate for Sheriff Wendez. His dedication to God, family, and Wayne County will never be forgotten. So let's not forget, all of us, that Teresa and the children and that family need our prayers now more than ever. So let's remember that as we move forward. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Doherty.
Mr. Chairman, I am going to dispense with a lot of my activities that I took place. And I'm very pleased to announce to everyone today, and I'm going to read the only one sentence from this press release that was issued today. Goldsboro, North Carolina, Wayne County, Wayne Memorial Hospital, and Blue Cross Blue Shield of North Carolina today announced a new 3-year contract effective immediately.
Thank you. I'm going to hold my comments until later on in the meeting. Takes care of the committee reports. I'm going to skip over unfinished business for just a minute and go ahead and go to new business. And we've reshuffled new business just a little bit. We've moved up to the first thing that we're going to take care of. Mr. Bob Jackson, if you would come forward. I think the Republican Party has got some information they want to share with us.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, board members.
Good morning.
We all miss Sheriff Wendez, but in his absence, we must put someone in as sheriff, and it became the duty of the Wayne County Republican Party Executive Committee to make that recommendation to this board. We met as a committee last evening, and each of you have a copy of our recommendation, and I'll read it in a moment. It was with a great deal of seriousness that we met last night. Some of you were there, and you understand that. And with great deliberations, we did decide on a person to submit to you this morning. And with your permission, I will read that letter that was drafted to this board. Please be advised, and it's to the Wayne County Commissioners from the Wayne County Republican Party Executive Committee. Please be advised that the Wayne County Executive Committee met in closed session on Monday, 3rd February 2014 at 6 p.m. to interview candidates for Wayne County Sheriff due to the vacancy left by Sheriff Kerry A. Wendez. The committee unanimously selected Lawrence Maxton Larry Pierce Jr. to be named Sheriff of Wayne County, NC for the remaining term of the late Sheriff Kerry A. Wendez. Larry is here this morning. Larry? Come here for a minute. It is the recommendation of the Wayne County Executive Committee that this board appoint Larry Pierce to be our new sheriff and to consider setting the swearing-in ceremony for approximately 14 days from today. Any questions?
Mr. Park?
Yeah, go ahead.
Larry, would you like, go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, board members, I appreciate the opportunity to serve this county if you see fit. We have lost a dear friend in the past 2 weeks and a man that was a law enforcement officer at heart. And I can't replace that, but I want to serve in that capacity at this time, and I appreciate your consideration.
Thank you, Larry. Mr. Parker, what's the procedure that we need to, as state statutes, we have to go by?
Statute allows the party from which the individual who vacated the office to give a recommendation to the Board of Commissioners for a replacement. The Board of Commissioners, if that party makes the recommendation within 30 days of the date of the vacancy, the Board of Commissioners must appoint the person that is recommended. If the person is otherwise qualified under the statutes to be sheriff, Mr. Pierce is clearly qualified under the statute to be sheriff. So it would be up to the Board of Commissioners to appoint him as the sheriff. He would, on his in his timeliness, determine when he wanted to be sworn in. You can appoint him today, and then he would determine when he wants to be sworn in. He does not have to be sworn in today or with any specific time limits. Major Greenfield continues until he is sworn in to perform the duties of the sheriff under the statute.
Any other questions for Mr. Parker?
Would that swearing in have to take place within a specific time?
No.
No.
I'm sure that Mr. Pierce would want to be sworn in when he feels like he's ready to assume the duties, but there is no specific time. And as Mr. Jackson said, he was recommended within about 14 days. The party was recommending that, and that's certainly within the law. But it would really be up to Mr. Pierce to determine when and where he will be sworn in.
Any other questions for Mr. Parker?
Yes, sir.
Or Mr. Pierce or Mr. Jackson?
Chairman.
Mr. Keene.
For clarity, is the sheriff, as we appoint him, before he is sworn in, is he not the sheriff today as we have appointed him to be? I understand the swearing in, but the longer we draw it out, counsel.
If you appoint him today, he is the going to be the sheriff. He is not the sheriff until he is sworn in and takes the oath. And that's what Major Greenfield would continue serving the duties of the sheriff.
Would there be any follow-up, Mr. Chairman? Would there be any consideration to move it up?
You want me to speak to that?
Yeah.
Okay. Go right ahead. Thank you. There are so many logistical things that have to be put into place that if we, at this point, we are all still deputies under Major Greenfield's direction. Once I become sheriff, at that point, I have to get those deputies sworn in a very timely fashion for the protection of Wayne County. And there are a lot of logistical problems right now. The main secretary is out with back surgery. Of course, we have lost our sheriff, and there are a lot of things that I have to do to get ready for that day, if I may.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. King.
Mr. Pate.
Just a quick, you know, I was there last night, and you just said you just had a very short time frame to handle your personal issues with your business, then you could go ahead and move to the logistical things you were speaking of. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I just wanted to be sure. And one other thing I just wanted to say, you were correct last night that it was a very serious deliberation. Sheriff Winters would have been very proud of the group that came there last night that spoke to us, and I thought each and every one of them
did a great job. I thought they all could have well served the position as sheriff. And again, I know that Kerry would have been very proud of the folks that he had working for him. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Mr. Chairman, do we need this in the form of a motion?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the recommendation of the Wayne County Republican Party and appoint Lawrence Maxton Larry Pierce Jr. as the sheriff of Wayne County.
I have a motion on the floor. Any other comments? If not, everyone in favor, show the sign of right hand. Motion carries unanimous.
Mr. Chairman, could I just make one other comment? We did have five people that indicated interest and showed up last night and was given equal time, and any one of the five could be sheriff, believe me. Very impressive. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. It won't take us just a minute, but I think this is a photo op. We'll make more whenever they're sworn in, but won't take but a minute.
I've added one more to it. Oh, here's the better. And by the way, I know that you have a job. I know that you're free time off your hands.
Well, y'all don't have to leave.
Oh, we're going to start skipping around again.
Court session.
I hear you. Well. Give us just a minute when we get started on the, we're going to skip about on the agenda. We're going to go take care of our work sessions next.
9:30 work session.
We're going to move into our work sessions. We're running a little bit late, but we're going to take care of the 9:30. Session request for North Carolina Eastern Regional Trust Funds. Mr. Mayo, if you would, I would like, since you kind of been involved in this, kind of take the lead on this work session, please.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. As a result of our last commissioner meeting, I wanted to remind the commissioners that we passed a motion that we would have presentations for the Eastern Region State Appropriation of $576,923 and some change, that we will have our presentations today and listen to anyone, any municipality or entity that wanted to come before us. And I want to also remind the board that also in that motion that we would have the responsibility as a commission board to set the priority on February 18th, which is our next meeting. And also the motion specifies that at that meeting we would make the priority and establish what projects would be actually put on the application to the Eastern Region. And also the board would need to pass a resolution to the Eastern Region. And I wanted to remind Mr. Parker that if we could have the resolution ready by the next meeting to the Eastern Region, and we can make a decision and also pass the resolution that same day on February 18th. And unless anyone has any questions about this, I wanted to, since Ms. Marsha Wilson has the names of the presentations this morning, I'd like to make a recommendation that we have 5 minutes or so per presentation, and then allow the board to ask any questions that may be pertinent. So I believe, Ms. Wilson, you have a list of the presentations this morning.
Our first request was from the town of Mount Olive.
Good morning. Commissioners, thank you for having me here. I'm not going to try to dazzle you with any technology. I'm too old for that.
Well, good, it didn't work.
I will give you a printed copy of our request. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
It's our understanding that these funds are designated or should be used for economic development. Under the picture's worth a thousand words category, if you look at the cover of this report, you'll notice that when Governor McCrory decided to come to Wayne County, you'll notice where he touched down on Friday. Thursday at 2 o'clock, we received a call. Wanted to know, was our runway cleared, because the governor wanted to come to attend services for Sheriff Winders. At 2 o'clock, our runway was not clear. At 4 o'clock in the afternoon, it was not only clear but dry. So we feel like, as Commissioner Cromartie said earlier, very active group with this airport. It's a very important economic tool, economic engine for Wayne County. This airport, the most recent Department of Commerce report, which was done prior to the addition of jet fuel at Mount Olive Airport, the airport contributed $8 million annually to the economy of Wayne County, not just Mount Olive, but to Wayne County. It accounts for 60 jobs, generates in excess of $200,000, I think the number's $234,000 in tax revenue for the local and state. So it is a tremendous economic asset to the county. We have one of the few industrial parks probably in the state that has a fully functional 5,000-foot runway within walking distance of the industrial park. We have jet fuel there. We have a full service airport with a very much sought-after fixed base operator who does excellent aircraft mechanic and inspector. So we think this is a tremendous asset to economic development in Wayne County. What we're asking for is help with matching funds. This airport was dedicated in 1967. 1970, it was named for General Chuck Yeager. The official name is Yeager Field. And the 3,700 foot of the original runway was probably there in 1967. It is in dire need of repair or rehab. We have been successful in acquiring $1.5 million in funds from the Division of Aviation. What we need now is help with the matching funds on that. The actual total in the matching funds is $168,000. We will need to do some additional work on the runway lighting. So what we're asking for is $200,000 to help with the match on that runway. This will be a complete rehab of that 3,700 feet. As you know, we extended the runway to 5,000 feet about 2 years ago. The new part of the runway is fine. We added jet fuel about a year ago. So if we can get this runway rehabbed and get the entire 5,000 feet in good shape, it will be a tremendous asset to Wayne County. That number, the $8 million economic impact figure, certainly has grown since the addition of jet fuel. It will certainly continue to grow with the addition of this runway rehab. So we are asking that you would favorably consider the request of Mount Olive, remembering that this airport facility is jointly owned by Mount Olive, Town of Mount Olive, and the County of Wayne. So Wayne County is partners in this endeavor, and you know, we would ask that you favorably consider our request, and I'll be glad to answer any questions that you might have.
Any questions?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Daugherty.
Well, one thing I've learned, if you ask for folks to come forth and ask for monies, they will definitely show up.
Yes, sir.
And I suppose my question would be that since it appears that the requests are far exceed our allocated funds, would a percentage or a portion of your request be helped?
Yes, sir. No, we. Yeah.
If in fact we could not.
Well, I understand that, and we understand too. Everybody in the county needs help, and we certainly would not want to stand in the way of Fremont, Pikeville, Eureka, anybody else who needs funding. Obviously, we would like to have our full request, but failing that, certainly we would welcome any assistance that the commissioners would see fit to bestow upon us.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anyone else? Mr. King.
I forgot what our allocation is per year for the airport. You said we were half owners. What do we allocate in our budget for the airport?
I believe it's $28,000.
That's right around, correct.
Yeah.
Good memory.
Yeah.
$28,000?
Yes, sir.
Each year?
Yes, sir.
For how long?
Forever. the town contributes.
Not in the future, but how long in the past?
How many years?
It's been, as long as I've been here 8 years, and it's always been that number. It actually may be 33. Pam, is that accurate? I think it is $33,000. The town contributes $40,000 annually to the operation of the airport. In addition, the town contributes $16,667 in matching funds to our Vision 100. So the total participation of the town of Mount Olive is $56,667 annually.
And ours is 33.
Sir?
Our
33,
ours is 33.
Yes, sir. That's correct.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Any other questions?
Just a little humor. Mr. Brown, I was doing a resolution to annex Mount Olive into Goldsboro.
You may get more opposition from Goldsboro.
Mr. Chairman.
King.
You know, that's not a bad idea. I mean, that's really, but I'm thinking about the other way around. Maybe council can help me with this. What's the possibility of conveying the county's park to the airport and have the city of Mount Olive own the airport?
We need to discuss that. If the board desired to do that and voted to do that, and if the town of Mount Olive was willing to accept it, it's fine.
Okay, that was just a question, not a suggestion. Okay, thank you, Council
Chairman.
Thank you, Marty.
I would want that thought to be carefully considered before any change was made, because the county of Wayne has invested a lot of money in the industrial park, and as Mr. Brown said, the airport is in walking distance of the industrial park, and with the funds that the county has invested in that industrial park, partnerships tend to be great and protective for all concerned. So without me having some vast knowledge of legalities, I would just want that all those things be carefully considered before we moved in that direction. But first things first, I appreciate Mr. Brown coming today and acknowledging that the southern part of the county is always concerned about the rest of the county. And Mr. Brown, I congratulate you on those concerns, that you would like to have that entire figure that you put down there, but I appreciate the fact that you understand that consideration has to be given for other areas.
Sure. Mr. Mayor, one question. The Mount Olive Airport Board.
Yes, sir.
We have a commissioner that's on that board, Wayne County Commission.
I don't know that there's a commissioner as a voting member of the board, but we always, you know, all the commissioners are always invited to those meetings. And I think there certainly would not be an issue with having a commissioner as a voting member of that airport board. It's never been done before, to my knowledge, but I don't think there would be any objection to that at all.
Okay, so that
the town of Mount Olive does not have a voting member on the board either, by the way.
So Wayne County does not have a commissioner that can vote on the board at this time?
Not at this time, no, sir.
Okay.
No, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
But I think in return for, you know, granting our request, we would certainly consider that.
any other questions for Mr. Brown?
Well, what we've been offered, two votes. Can we borrow any?
That appropriation for the Mount Olive Airport for the 13-14 fiscal year is $33,281.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hope.
Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Thank you. Appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, just for clarity, that was not a suggestion.
The town of Fremont.
Good morning.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I am the interim town manager. I'm Barbara Acock from the town of Mount Fremont. Y'all been talking about Mount Olive so much, I'm wanting to join the team too. I have some extra letters here from a citizens on our issue here. If it's okay, I'd like to pass these out, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
If we could pass these down. They came in after the fact. I am sorry for this. I tried to get everything in. But I feel like this is one of our homeless citizens in Fremont.
Gee, thanks.
We got to keep it all, you know. Yes, I am. Wayne is a very good relative and a very good friend. I have already sent you what our issues are in Fremont. I started in Fremont November 1st. When I came there, I began to take an issue with some of the finances. Actually, Wednesday, we have a visit from the LGC because of the financial issues we have. I've tried to give you all the information to be very upfront with our issues. We are in dire need to help get rid of some debt that we went into years ago. I think the previous boards, they done what they thought was right, but in the prospect, we continually accumulated debt. And we're at the point now that we just cannot do some other projects. We've got two grants that we've just been awarded, but they also have money that has to be put forth. I also have that in the packet. We have a Norway lift station that's going to cost about $50,000 to repair. This station is in such dire need, the walls are beginning to collapse, it needs a new liner, and we need to get that fixed, but we do not have the funds to fix it. Also, we would like, I have gone through the finances and found four economic development loans that the town has for approximately $251,880. If we could start working on getting some of the debt removed for the town, that would help the town immensely to go forth to create more grants, maybe hopefully to fix other issues we have. We're like a lot of small towns. We have a lot of issues. And we also have a lot of citizens who are on very limited incomes. And our sewer rates right now are, we just can't go any further with our sewer rates. I mean, it would not be fair to the citizens to continually raise, and I don't think that's the way to fix a problem. I think it's a way of managing the problem. I have all my boards and citizens here that are here with me today. I have the mayor, Flowers, and our engineer. We have a lot of support for this project, and we need help. We're at the back door. We just don't know which door to go through. And we're a small town. Yes, we've made mistakes, like a lot of boards have. So we're here today to have you maybe help us with some of this debt, help us with the lift station, and help us be able to move forward as a small town. Because that's what it's all about, small towns, saving small towns. And we need help. And that's why we're here today. And if we can get some of that help, I have promised the board to come out of retirement and help. And we're going to do a new non-traditional role. I will be like a part-time town administrator to save money on salary. This money will help pay the difference in what we are currently paying on our loans now. And they have agreed to that. And hopefully, with their help, they are very involved now. I have, with meetings, we have had very strong financial issues that we have discussed and brought forward. And my comment to the board, you need to put it out, let everybody see it. We need help. And if anybody can offer help, let's get it. And that's where we're at now. Does anybody have any questions?
Questions?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Mayor.
I see in your statement here you want to pay off the principal of a $251,880 debt.
Yes, sir.
Actually refinance is what you're saying.
Yes, sir. That is a refinance. If we could refinance and save the interest, we would save over $108,519 worth of interest if we could pay these loans here off. Some of them are 20 years, some of them are 10 years. But if we work diligently, we could save this money, which would go back into our accounts. And that would help us build up our general fund and our water and electric funds to save this kind of money. That's a lot of money. And that's why I put together these four loans. I looked at them, what we could afford to pay back and what we could work with. And these four loans are the ones that I came up with and the amount that we could save. I don't feel we're actually in $1,000,009 in debt, and this is just $251,000 worth of debt. But that any amount that we can get removed would help the town immensely.
Follow up, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes. So my next question is that you have taken some steps to make sure that you can pay back to the county what you want to borrow. Is that correct?
You've yes,
taken
sir.
Steps to trim your budget and do whatever it takes to do that.
One of them is to reduce in salary for a full-time town administrator.
Yeah.
And I have agreed to work with the board on that. I mean, we will save probably about $30,000 with me doing it than having to pay someone else to pay their benefits and their salary. And that's a lot of money. And That is what I do, basically do. I do consultant works with other small towns, and I've helped Town of Sharpsburg when they had problems. I've helped M City some. I've helped the Town of Hookton. And I also am here with Fremont now. Well, this is about one of the toughest ones that I've to come in with far as finances and everything. And I thought Sharpsburg, the Town of Sharpsburg, was really bad. But if we can get some help and support, I feel like we can move forward with the board's backing now. They're on board. The mayor, everyone is on board. And that's what we need. Everybody has to buy into this project, and they have.
Could you give us some background about the sewer system? I have gone myself and taken a tour of the sewer system and why it's in place. But I understand that back when all the grants and everything took place, that I believe John Carr had something to do with that as far as the grants are concerned. And I'm just wondering if somebody could give us just a tiny window of how that took place and how we ended up with one of the better sewer systems in the county. But it's important that, and you've already said this, that it's important that you maintain it for future economic development.
Yes, sir.
So could someone just give us a little bit of window of how this grant came about years ago? And I think Eureka and Fremont were partners in this. Am
yes.
I correct on that?
I have Mayor Flowers here. He has the history more on this.
Okay.
We talk about economic development. Fremont has had sewer problems for 30 years. As a solution to the sewer problem, roughly 10 years ago, we worked out an agreement with Goldsboro that they would treat our sewage. We now have a 12-inch sewer line from Eureka to Fremont and from Fremont to Goldsboro. Now, our issue is we're asset rich and money poor. There is not another area in Wayne County better suited, with the exception of natural gas, for economic development as a result of that action than northeastern Wayne County. Our issues now is, as Mount Olive said, in order to get grants, you have to have in-kind monies to provide for your share. And we've almost maxed out. If you go in addition to that, I should say, we have 660,000 gallons per day of capacity in the Goldsboro plant. 660,000 gallons per day capacity in addition to those lines. We are presently providing sewer service for the airport. We're providing sewer service for 4 schools in the county. And we have the capability of providing sewer service much beyond that point, with the water and the sewer in northeastern North Carolina. And as I say, with the exception of the natural gas, you won't find a more suitable area in the world for economic development. I think, does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. Thank you, sir.
We did that with the assistance of Senator Carr and those others that were representing us up there, with a lot of state and federal monies, but also some local matches that have created some difficulties with us in the present time.
Okay, can I? Okay, go ahead, Bill. I'm sorry.
You mentioned, probably open in Pandora's box, you mentioned that you're supplying sewer for 4 schools, the airport, was there another one, and the Town of Fremont?
Well, Eureka, the Town of Fremont, the airport, 4 sewer systems, and two rest homes.
My question is all of those that's involved, are they paying their fair share?
We are, have asked the staff to review now to make sure that we're not being undercharged, or that we're not undercharging the rates. And we've got our resident engineer that could really respond to that better than I. But we have a TV camera that we can use for the sewer lines. We have now have cameras, have run that camera through the school's lines to see if there was any infiltration there. We've done it for the airport as well. We are looking at it to make sure that they do pay their fair share.
Okay. I guess my question is, I mean, is their input to the system, is it metered? I mean, do you know what they're...
We throughout the town and these entities are metering through water usage, not through sewer usage. And our engineer would have to respond beyond that point. There's a tremendous expense, as I understand it, for the meters that would convert it from water usage to sewer usage.
Anyone else have any?
Well,
Mr. Pate?
Yeah, a lot of what I was going to ask you guys are already asking. But I think it's important that the people in the county realize that we have the sewer system in the northern end of the county. And the help that we need in the northern end of the county, I don't see us get left behind, because I think we've been excluded at some points. I am interested to find out, like you just said, about the metering that's coming out of those other people who are hooked onto the line, because I understand the cost tends to rise. For example, I looked at some of the things that you gave me, Barbara, that when school is in session, the cost rises. And when they're out, it goes down. So it appears to me that there's some infiltration coming somewhere there, and then perhaps in the schools, which are part of county assets too, need to be part of this equation and how we figure this out. I see the continued investment in this system is an economic impact for the northern end of the county, and I think it's wise to help them out, and I really believe that. What other steps have you taken to scope those? I mean, that you've got the engineer here at the schools and the other site that's hooked on. Have y'all taken a look at that? And are there meters there, or do they need to be included? Or
they are not meters there. What we are trying to do right now is do pump drawdown tests to see how much they're pumping into it. I think the Norwayne School is the one that gravity flows into the pump station that's about to fall in. But we're trying to get a handle on exactly how much sewage is coming from those different locations, and make sure that our meter is calibrated where we dump into Goldsboro's system as well. So we're trying to make sure that everything is reading correctly to make sure that we're not getting overcharged or getting undercharged from others. Either way, we want it to be exactly right. And of course, the other big factor that we y'all really haven't talked about is the lagoon. We've got a leaking lagoon in Fremont, and we are currently under special order of consent with the Environmental Management Commission. We're already 2 years into that, and we've got to get that fixed. And that is a big chunk of the money that we're talking about trying to get. I mean, that's $1 million fix.
Everybody needs to understand that, you know, that if this system fails, not only does it affect Eureka and Fremont, it affects the schools, and it'll impact the city of Goldsboro as well. So this is a system that's got to be fixed. It's got to be addressed. And I want us to think very closely about that.
If I may say that if you ask about our effort, we're doing that on ground. We met with Goldsboro about the rates, and we're going to meet with Goldsboro again. We've met with the county about the airport, and we are in line. We have not set up a meeting. When the schools read this in the paper, they have not been involved as yet. But it is our intent to involve them with meetings as well as soon as we get the data that we need to present to them. But we have made every effort that we know of to try to resolve some of these issues and be sure that the issues are ours and not someone else's.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Daugherty.
I'm always the bad guy, but I read this one sentence here. It says, "North Carolina State Grant for Economic Development is being given to the counties to loan to municipalities for economic development projects." And my question is going to be maybe to council, and that is, would refinancing fall under a economic development project that would qualify under this? That basically is going to be a question that arises.
If I may respond, the issue is economic. It is a dollar issue with the tank. The economic development certainly falls back on the sewer lines.
Agreed.
And without having some financial relief, then we are having difficulties with that portion of it. It may not be a direct impact, but the indirect impact is probably greater than anywhere possibly in the county, because as I say, we're not covering Fremont. We're covering the entire northeastern Wayne County in this economic development issue.
I would just not like to have it rejected because it didn't qualify.
It's my opinion that it would qualify, and that the eastern region has indicated that it would qualify.
Very well.
There's one other step, though. If Fremont wants to borrow money, they've got to go to the LGC to get the LGC's permission to borrow money, as does the county if you want to borrow as much as is available to you.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, being on the Eastern Regional Board along with Commissioner Bell, the attorney for the Eastern Region, I do not have this in writing. I do have it per phone conversation, and other counties are doing this, by the way. They're taking their appropriation of 576, and you can use it for refinancing. As long as it's an economic development, if it qualifies for a new project, it also qualifies for refinancing.
Okay, thank you.
Now, one comment, getting back to the sewer system. This board has no control over, you know, what the schools put into your sewer system, or what the town of Fremont puts in, or Eureka, or any other privately owned businesses. But I think I can speak for the board. Wayne County will pay their part for the airport. The airport is Wayne County's, and Wayne, you know, find out what, you know, if it takes a meter or your water meter, whatever it takes, I think I can speak for the rest of the board and assure you that Wayne County will pay their part pertaining to the airport.
And Chairman Acott, we have been working on that also. Okay. Thank you for that.
Anyone else?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Bell.
I just want to say that when you get ready to fill out the application, you need to stress economic development. You know, although you're going to refinance, but it still should be economic development.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bell.
Anyone else?
Mr. Chairman, my question is about you all having to interact with LGC and the timeline that we're facing in terms of making that official request to Eastern Region. Mr. Attorney, is there something they need to immediately do, or will we borrow the money and then they'll have a little more
We're meeting with LGC
time.
Tomorrow.
Okay.
And I would.
I want to get the timeline straight so there wouldn't be no mix up with that.
Yeah. I'm very familiar with working with the LGC, and hopefully they can see what we're trying to benefit here.
Any other questions?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. King.
Questions on the lagoon part. Is that what steps have you taken so far to get your lagoon taken care of as far as application back to the Environmental Management Commission and requesting funds for the grant?
We have complied thus far with the first parts of the requirement of the SOC, which is to do a sludge study to find out how much sludge is actually in the bottom of the lagoon. Turns out there's not as much in there as we thought. The other piece that we're trying to do, we have been successful in getting two, and I think y'all probably have this information, about $1.4 million in what I call 50% principal forgiveness and 50% loan. Of course, the town is not in the position to take much debt. And that's where we are now. What we're also trying to do is there's a new round of CDBG money coming out.
Right.
I understand that those applications will be due sometime in April, and probably sometime around the 1st of May, they'll be announcing those, and we're actively seeking those grants. Those will be a much smaller match, probably in the $40,000 to $50,000 range versus, you know, $700,000 like they've got now.
Okay.
So we are, the main thing that we're trying to do right now is find a way to pay for it.
Yes, and that leads up to my question, if I can follow up, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
The concern that I have is that it's impossible for you to prepare a budget. It's just impossible for you to do that. When you look at your lagoon issue, and you go back and look at statistics from July 2012, in August of 12, $30,000 a month to the city of Goldsboro, $20,000 a month in September, $34,000, and then $15,000 in November. But in January, February, March, it goes from $10,000 to $68,000 a month, $67,000 for the next month, and $66,000 for the next month. And then you fall in April, $16,000. And then when June, July, and August come, and you look at the months, and I've gone back and looked at the rain days, it goes back up to $45,000, $85,000, and $37,000, respectively. And we're talking about the infiltration, and we're talking about the schools that has been mentioned, and then we talk about the lagoons. And now, in December, estimated was $44,000, up from $13,000 in November. And then in the September meeting we had with all the municipalities in the county, you had a councilman to state that this time next year we'll be broke. Quote. And I took that very seriously in September. And then, of course, when I talked to Mr. Mayo, because it's in his district, and then we got into Eureka, there is no way you can understand how to pay anything back if you are unsure about the infiltration, the lagoon issue, is that your lagoon gets filled, or you have issues with it. And then you have to ship this to Goldsboro.
Let me see if I can kind of shed some light on what's happening there. During the winter months that you're talking about, where you're seeing the great rise in the cost that they're paying to Goldsboro, those are the months that they can spray very little
right,
on their
lagoon.
From the lagoon.
Right.
And during the, you know, if they come across a dry period and they can spray more, you'll see that cost go down. So a lot of that is what you're seeing, that diurnal pattern that you see is based strictly on the ability to land apply the wastewater.
Yes.
The other part, obviously, if you look at the rainfall data, part of that is infiltration.
Yes.
And it's kind of hard to differentiate completely in between the two, but that's kind of where we are. You know, when you can't spray but just very little during the winter months, you know, you're forced, once that lagoon gets full, you've got to send it to Goldsboro. You've got no choice.
Well, I have a lot of pig farmers in my district, and I understand it completely.
My concern
here is how you're talking about paying the monies back. How do you budget how to make the payments? And your year end is in June 30, and we have studied the airport, putting meters on that to meter the water and the sewer. The schools are being looked at now to meter that. The way I understand it is that in Goldsboro, you have a unit that measures the water, but not the sewer intake. And it's calculated by the water usage, the capacity use. Is that correct?
Not in Goldsboro. Where it goes into Goldsboro, there is a meter.
For
sewage.
For sewage.
Yes.
So that trunk line that feeds into Goldsboro,
yes,
there's a meter there. And it's taking everything that's hooked on. Eureka, Fremont,
schools, everything.
I think you said a business, airport, and a couple of nursing homes. So all of that feeds into that trunk line. Now, how is it that Fremont, can they go over to the schools and get meters set to understand if there's infiltration in the school lines or is it infiltration in the trunk line?
Well,
where you were that?
The line that you're talking about feeding from the three of the schools is actually a force main.
Okay.
It's not a gravity line.
But it goes into the trunk, the main trunk.
Well, it goes into the line, the meter there at another pump station, mm-hmm. which I think is or a metering system there at Paytown Road, down 117. The trunk lines, the gravity trunk lines, are inside the city itself. Where those pieces, with the exception of Norway, all of those are pump stations that are pumping into a force main.
Okay.
And it's not a gravity system. Now, their system is gravity, obviously, from the building, but it's getting pumped into the force main and sent on to Hillsborough, and it goes through that same meter.
Mike, again, it's if you know the sewage, the intake, the capacity, the water, there's no problem. But the sewer coming into Goldsboro, and Goldsboro billing you, Fremont, it bills you. It doesn't bill the schools, the way I understand it. It doesn't bill Eureka. It bills Fremont.
That's right.
And Fremont, it's hard for me as a business person to understand if I don't know what my bills are going to be in utility cost. It's going to be very, very, just it's going to be impossible for me to set my rates. Is it going to be 3% of my budget? Is it going to be 20% of my budget? And the way it looks like is that sewer and the letters from some of the people that the citizens that live there, it's really unbelievable that you're even surviving today because of this cost. It could be 20 or 30% of your total budget.
Well,
just sewer.
The second part of this, what we're looking at, the money that we've been awarded through the state Clean Water Revolving Grant Program, is I&I. We're going to continue to button up those trunk lines as much as we can to make sure that we've cut them back. The town of Fremont has even gone over to Eureka to try to help them button up their system because, those citizens are paying Fremont whatever comes to them.
That's right.
So the more of that we can stop, you're never going to stop it all. You never. I mean, you can chase it for the next 20 years. You're never going to stop every bit of it. But all you can do is try to get as much of it out as you can. You find the big sources and hope you get lucky right. And you find something. But
if I can follow up, Mr. Chairman, and I'll finish. If I just one more statement. Thank you. I'm just going to get right into economic development, and I'm going to finish. You cannot economically survive if you continue to raise rates to take care of this cost.
That's correct.
Your businesses will not locate in Fremont. They will not locate in Eureka. The fees are going to be so high, and you're going to try to recapture your cost by fees instead of getting this fixed. Now, getting this fixed is paramount. And for economic development, that's my case, is that in order for you to grow, this has got to be fixed.
And that's
and you've got to. and you can't pass that fee to get it fixed onto the citizens.
The citizens in Fremont are already in the top tier of rates in the state.
That's
by comparison.
I remember that in September when we met with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
And
thank you.
Which is unfortunate. And
very.
And of course, a lot. You got about a 25% poverty rate in Fremont. And it's an unfortunate situation, but they've got an investment in it, and there's a lot of issues. And I agree with you. It's the chicken and the egg. We got to get it fixed, but until we get it fixed, you can't expand.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Mayor, one follow-up. Yes, I agree. You're saying we would never do away with 100% infiltration, but 10 million gallons difference per year between Goldsboro reading and Fremont reading is not acceptable.
No.
Is that correct?
That is correct.
And that's what we're facing here. Am I correct in that?
That is correct.
On the average, about 10 million gallons a year difference. And what is that costing Fremont in money?
Well, I don't have the exact figure, but you're looking at $5.49 per 1,000 gallons is what the town of Fremont pays Goldsboro to accept that sewage.
Okay.
So you can see it's a fairly high magnitude number there.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anyone else? Thank y'all.
Wait a minute, I did have, excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
I was trying to ignore you.
I think the point was well taken, that until you resolve this excess flow, you're just spinning wheels here. So I would, you know, I'd really encourage you to avail yourself of using these dollars in order to pay for those improvements, identifying the problem and getting those solutions, because we're talking about a huge amount of inflow here, a huge amount of inflow. And until you resolve that, you really haven't resolved the underlying problem. I mean, Goldsboro is sitting here accepting all that that's coming in, running a meter and charging you accordingly. It doesn't make any difference in regards to whether or not that came from stormwater runoff or whether or not it's, you know, sewage that actually needs to be treated.
That's right.
All of it has to be treated. So I would just encourage you to get the grants and the loans necessary to solve the problem. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
If I may.
Yes, sir.
We haven't brought Deaner into it, but one of our problems with all of this, the charges to Goldsboro, was the limited regulations that limited the usage of our lagoons and also of the spray fields.
Sure.
Deaner met with us this fall. They have they have modified the requirements, and they are working with us as well. So we are trying to address every issue. The inflow issues, if they are major issues, are not in that main line, I don't believe. And the inflow issues in the schools, they may be issues, but I don't think they are major issues that are causing the excess costs. We need to meet with Goldsboro again. We need to talk about the rates. Deaner is helping us. This is a poor year to judge how good the modifications are with all the rain and snow that we've had. But we have attempted to do exactly what you're saying.
Thank you.
Could I add one more, please? just a clarification for the engineer. Are we losing gallons in these lift stations? Are we losing anything in the lift stations?
Not in the lift stations per se, no, sir.
Even though the fiberglass linings are, I know you have one that the lining is, the concrete wall is there.
It would be very little in that one spot, I suspect.
Okay.
But I think most of it is probably in the service laterals and in the mains in town. It's probably where the majority of it is. And that's where we concentrate most of the I&I rehab.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Anyone else?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. No, we'll take 30 seconds. And I sit on the MC, as you know, and we're over Deaner and DWQ and air quality and so forth for the state. But this current administration has made a promise to lessen restrictions, to be more customer friendly, to not come in and slap your hand and throw a fine on you. It's good to hear that, not crossing the line here, Council, for conflict of interest, but I'm just making a comment that working with you, I'm glad to hear that from a mayor, I'm glad to hear that from council and from the management, that Deaner is coming in and actually being customer friendly and wanting to help, and from especially an engineer. I'll pass that back on to you.
And please do, because I work with Deaner a lot of different towns and all across the state, and they have been great to work with. They have been much better, much easier to get hold of.
Good.
And have really tried to help us.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Thank y'all. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you,
Commissioners.
Thank you for coming.
All right, we are way behind schedule. We'll have our public comments at 10 o'clock. Council or Ms. Marshall, I need some guidance here on.
Let's do public.
public comments?
There's a public comment since they're set at 10 o'clock.
We're running about 40 minutes late on public comments. We're going to open the public comment section up. You're limited to 4 minutes. State your name, address, and phone number, please.
What's up, Tom Heffler, Massey Road, Dead Little Carolina, 689-9834. I'm here more than anything else. I've talked to a lot of y'all the past couple of weeks. We've had a tough time, and I'm more than here to thank a lot of people. Y'all did an excellent job in helping us out. Not just counting y'all, our EMS people, our county departments, Tim Rogers. If it weren't for him, we probably wouldn't have the ceremonies we did for the sheriff going through this thing. And there's not enough people I can name. I've got a whole list of them. If I name everybody, I'm gonna miss a bunch of them. I just want to ask to keep our new sheriff and others in your prayers. And I will say one thing. You know how the sheriff was. You know when he got to heaven, he went over there and said, "Lord, let me do one more thing to these guys." He sat there. He sent us that sleep. He sent us that snow. He tried us. And I think working together, we've made him proud. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Tom Drew, P.O. Box 587, Goldsboro, 27533. As I addressed last night before the Board of Education, suicide's a tough, tender subject to address in their 3 minutes or these 4 minutes. Did my best to pick up from those 3 minutes. I did do an email last night to both boards, which now is a public record containing these 4 pages. Pass that down. And we'll do a subsequent email containing this 1 page. I'm sure I got my copy. News Argus last summer concerned about this board not having the benefit of vetting during the electoral due process, which they were guilty of that problem themselves. And they would censor the card post from meeting that need. Back in 2000 election, that single page contains report 389, Judge Ian. That is the card post in its top-notch form then, before the censorship of the News Argus impeding the form. Right beside it is 383, which begins reading all in all in. To enhance the ability of the Wayne County citizens to be the most informed voters on earth. Now re-request, I don't know who's on request here, the answers to the 3 questions in 389 of this board, dated and signed. What is your definition of the word form? Do you recognize the forum as the foundation of education and democracy? And the third one, which of the following is the leading preventable cause of premature death? Now, had A, B, and C. A was tobacco. B is loneliness and despair. C is other. Please specify. That B, loneliness and despair, significantly addresses the suicide crisis. At that time, that would have been my answer. My answer today, as far as C, please specify other, it's education. Significantly in education addressed last night, the follow-up reporting to the tragedy in Rosewood a couple of Mondays back, the following Wednesday, the interview of top educators quoted as saying, "We'll never know why." The following Sunday, the News Argus editorial, unsigned, ended on that same note, reaffirming that person's statement, "We'll never know why." I welcome the News Argus this Sunday to explain to the public and myself why they think we'll never know why such tragedies happen. This crisis can be stabilized and turned around in 30 days on a shoestring budget. make some kind of progress. The Card Post welcomes any and all opinions, questions, and suggestions on suicide on a postcard, signed or unsigned. And in 30 days, make copies of those opinions, questions, suggestions. Make sure every hotline worker has something interesting to read when hopefully they're not answering the phone. That can be done in 30 days on a shoestring budget. All you need is a P.O. box and a copy.
Thank you, Mr. Drew, for your comments. Anyone else have any comments?
Well, we're going to live.
Public comment session is closed. The pleasure of the board, where we go back and pick up at.
We haven't finished. We have some more requests for the North Carolina's Eastern Region.
Okay, let's go back to the work session, the 9:30 work session, request for Eastern Region.
Our next request was from the City of Goldsboro.
For those that might not know me, I'm Scott Stevens, Goldsboro City Manager. I do appreciate the opportunity to come and speak to the commissioners about the potential loan money from the North Carolina Eastern Region Trust Fund. After listening to the other communities and their projects, I would tell you ours ought to be third priority. If the others meet the criteria, then I think from a standpoint of communities working together, I would echo really what the others would say as well. We want to fund what really needs it first. We feel like we have two good projects. And I at least wanted to discuss those with you. We discussed these projects with the Goldsboro City Council last evening. They did ask that we come and ask for funding if it was available, and our understanding was it's somewhere in the neighborhood of $575,000 existed within Wayne County, with the potential for other counties that might be willing to loan that money. So there may be more money available than just the $575,000. The two projects that we'd like to put forward and funds that would help really Goldsboro balance our financial plans, and we have a lot of balls in the air with both of these projects in terms of where the money's coming from and how we get there, and we will complete the projects. But I would like to put together two of ours, and our first priority would be our Berkeley Boulevard widening project. It's been a partnership with the Department of Transportation. We have close to $1 million in right-of-way acquisition and moving utilities and some additional costs, which I hope you have in front of you, that are upcoming for us on this project. And we request $450,000 to complete that. And again, it is widening Berkeley Boulevard to four lanes, adding in some turn lanes, and really from Royal Avenue northward to New Hope Road. And that project, as our schedule is with DOT today, would go to construction for the roadway work in June of this year, but the utility work relocation is ongoing and more to come in the coming months. So that is the first request, and I've got the details there that I'd be happy to answer questions for in just a minute. Our second project, and really the second priority, and just depending on funding availability, would be the reimbursement for engineering and design services with our downtown center streetscape project. We have always intended to borrow the funds in terms of the engineering work as we move those projects forward. The interest rate and the terms with the money that's available seem to be very favorable, and so either of these projects would be beneficial, and any amount of funding would be considered. If there were a couple $100,000 left at the end of it, we'd be interested in talking to you about that. If the full amount could be funded, we would certainly appreciate that as well. As I said earlier, if these projects meet the criteria for economic development and the Eastern Region criteria, which we believe they would, we would be interested in funding for them, but the other communities need to be weighed and considered as well. So with that, I'd answer any questions you might have. And
any questions for Mr. Stevens? Any comments?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. King.
Scott, on the Berkeley Boulevard, from the base to Ash, from Ash to 70, bypass is now, or is it from 70 out to the new?
Yeah, the Berkeley widening project is from Royal Avenue, so basically US 70 with some turn lanes in that area. So US 70 north to New Hope. And we currently have a three-lane section there, two lanes going north and one lane coming south. I believe there's a center turn lane that will add an additional southbound lane from New Hope down to Royal Avenue with turn lanes at Royal Avenue and turn lanes, right turn lanes going on to US 70. Which won't solve the Berkeley Boulevard traffic problems, but it certainly will help them.
Is there any property acquisitions in?
We have acquired all of the property through that. That was the partnership the city had with the Department of Transportation, and we have invested close to $1 million in property acquisition along that parcel. All of those have either been acquired or we've acquired a few through condemnation. So we have rights to those properties at this point, still some to settle.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anyone else? Thank you, Scott.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate your generosity in considering the other two requests.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next request is from the town of Pikeville.
Last and certainly not least, first I'd like to say thank you, John, for talking to me. I'm not related to Commissioner Acock, and I don't plan on annexing Goldsboro, not after that. We just found out about this. We discussed this last night at our commission meeting. It's kind of a hurry-up project. As you know, we're probably the closest community on the interstate, I-795, between Goldsboro and Wilson. And we just, in December, annexed the southern side of the western, east and west side of the southern part of 795, south of the Pikeville-Princeton Road. And last night we changed that zoning from agricultural to commercial. We are in the process of seeking tenants or somebody to buy that property for commercial development. We have one problem, and that is the age of our wastewater storage tank, which we use for pressure to go into one of our spray fields. It's an old tank. It used to be our water tank, and then it's now our wastewater storage tank. And we are looking for $75,000 to rehab that facility. Without that facility, our entire waste treatment system, the viability is extremely compromised. And that's what we're asking for. And it's nothing like Fremont. We don't have the capacity, or we'd help you. If there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Any questions? Mr. Mayor.
Yes, do you have, do we have this in a written form?
I do not, sir. This just happened last night.
Yes.
And
I sent you an email.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. So, but we have the engineers or the business that maintains our water tank now also has the information on our storage tank. And that's why I came up very quickly with the $75,000.
Mr. Darney.
Am I understanding that your sewer system is all contained there in Pikeville and that you are not shipping anything to Goldsboro?
That's correct. We have our own lagoons. We have three spray fields. We have one central pivot and two pop-ups. The tank, the old water tank, which is the waste treatment storage, that gives the pressure for spraying the field at Jericho Farms.
Are you having a lot of infiltration problems?
Not like we used to have. Used to be, say 10, 12 years ago, our normal inflow was 65 to 70,000 gallons. After a big storm, it was 600,000 gallons. But now we've done a lot of repairs. We're in the process of doing more. Diener, again, is being very, very patient about that. We're still getting 65 to 70,000 on a normal day, but maybe on last July, which is the wettest month for several years, it was 190,000 gallons a day. So it's not quite like what it was. But we are working on that, but it's the system that we're trying to keep functional. That's why we need the...
Well, I mean, I just hear a lot about sewer problems, and the economic development is totally tied to availability of sewer.
That's exactly right.
But that's capacity as well. So if you got an inflow coming in to that extent, then it affects your capacity.
That's correct.
So, you know, I think all of the communities are going to handle this inflow problem.
As I said, 10 years ago, our inflow INI was 600,000 gallons a day. when it would have been a million gallons a day last July, based on the old system. Our lagoon system is functional. We have 140,000 gallon per day sewage capacity. For most intents and purposes, we don't go over 110,000 gallons a day. It was an extraordinary month last July. And Diener is aware of that. So we're within bounds as it is, and we are working on I'm getting funds for a PER, that's a preliminary engineering report, to finalize the final section of our INI problem. As somebody said, you're never going to get rid of all INI, but if you can get rid of 90% to 95% of it, then you're doing good.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Camardi.
I would just like to ask this question as a
yes, sir.
Real greenhorn about processing sewer and all that. And since we have Goldsboro here, whenever he spoke about having the 10,000 gallons, or say if it was coming from Fremont, and they were doing 10,000 gallons a day, and then we had the big rains and everything, and it jumped to 100,000 gallons a day. My question would be, when it gets to Goldsboro, does it take the equipment the same capacity or ability or whatever we want to categorize it as to treat that 10,000 back then when it was real sewer versus the 100,000, there may be a lot of rainwater in there?
If I can answer that, if you can. I deal with this all the day, all the time. There's all kinds of jokes, but we're a mixed company. When I was in Fairmont, we had a plant that was, you know, five times the size of what we needed. So I went out and we had five other cities on the system. And I want to tell Commissioner Keene the problems with metering the inflow of sewer is very, very big. I learned that the hard way. But when a plant is built, it's designed to build for a certain capacity. when it up to that capacity, it works fine. There's a little, for better lack of better, little bugs eat the stuff, okay? And when you have too much water in there, when you have INI, which is rainwater or whatever, it dilutes the mixture, if you will. And the little bugs have to work harder, and it doesn't work as well. Is that right? That's the...
I think he's given a very simple explanation and a good response. And I would tell you, for Goldsboro in particular, we have INI problems issues within our collection system as well. They're pretty significant. We've gone through a flow study trying to address those. We're going to pour several million dollars, maybe as much as $10 million, towards fixing those problems in the next 5 to 10 years, trying to reduce that INI at our wastewater plant. We do have the benefit of two very large lagoons at our wastewater treatment plant. Those are some concern to the Air Force because they're under their runway. But those lagoons do provide us with a lot of stores. So although our plant, I think its capacity is 14 million gallons a day it can treat, we normally see about 7 during these heavy rainfall periods or high water table time frames. We'll see in excess of that, and we divert to the lagoons, and then we treat it later. Right. All of us in our sewer business have a lot of invested or capital cost in it, and many of us have debt on those facilities, and then we have staff. So those are sort of our fixed costs. When you asked about the additional treatment of more water or sewage, for us it's incremental. The incremental cost is somewhat less than those base costs that you have to cover, because it's power. We're not adding staff. We're not adding other capital, but more power, more chemicals, and running at higher rates of speeds on equipment. So there's some incremental cost above those fixed sort of costs. But our rates are designed to capture and cover all of that.
All right. And if I don't get too elementary in my guessing with the dollars, if the cost to treat that other 90,000 gallons is incremental, should that cost not reflect what they have to pay coming from up there to pay not that full $68,000, whatever it was, but just let that scale slide so that if it's incremental for you to treat the other 90,000 gallons, I would wish that additional cost would be incremental also. Am I missing something?
I think what you're saying, it's incremental higher, it's not incremental lower. So you've got your base costs. This is the cost that you normally run it.
All right.
And then it costs additionally more.
Well, Commissioner McMartin, I would tell you the rates can be established probably any way we'd want to establish them. If we need whatever our annual budget in sewer is about $8 or $9 million, if we need $8 or $9 million for Goldsboro sewer system, no matter how much water comes through us or sewage, we'd have to get that amount of money to run our plant. So the rates are designed to recover those costs. So that's how all of us are doing rates. Mm-hmm. Could we have it where you have a base rate that's higher, so you're getting this much, and then when you get above a certain number, it gets cheaper? We probably used to have those rates, but in conservation mode, the state has really pushed us and the federal government to not have those rates, because those rates don't encourage people to reduce their sewage uses. And so that's some of the challenge in the rate making. Could it? Yes.
But I'm looking at Fremont up there.
Yes, sir.
If that cost escalates out of the window whenever it rains, and unless I've got it back, it's going to cost less to treat that other 90,000 gallons because it doesn't have that same amount of stuff that those little bugs need to eat, then I'm thinking that the cost should be less. I'm not saying that you should reduce it and make you not, but I'm just thinking about consideration for the people up the line. That's all I'm trying to get to.
I think, sir, that you have it backwards. It actually costs more. It doesn't cost less. The incremental costs are higher because he said we do have to, the equipment has to work harder. We have to spend more electricity. We have to spend more chemicals because it's over and above what is designed.
I misunderstood what incremental meant.
I wouldn't say that it's that incremental cost is higher. So we may be in a little different place. For me, I have fixed costs. Mm-hmm. We have our debt, we have our staff, mm-hmm. we have everything here, that's and if it's $5 million a year, that's $5 million a year.
Right.
And that may be a base load of 7 million gallons a day, which is my average sewer flow into the wastewater plant. So when I get some more flow above that, that cost, all these fixed costs are already mostly here. Now, they're in all the rates, but if you truly got into my average cost of treatment versus what's the next 100 gallons cost me or the next 1,000, it probably is slightly less because I don't have the fixed cost. My operational cost incrementally might be a little higher, but all those fixed costs are already in that base flow. But our rates are designed to recover our costs, whatever they are. So if I reduce for a Fremont that rate here, then I've got to increase it somewhere else because my overall costs are still going to be that $8 or $9 million a year.
Yeah. Please understand, I was sort of advocating for Mr. Flowers over there.
Yes, sir. And we're with them too. We've had good conversations, and I'm sure we'll have some more, but we're sympathetic to their plight as well.
We've also decided not to annex the airport.
Mr. Mayor, question. Well, Scott, I appreciate you sharing that because that's exactly what Fremont Pipeline New Rico trying to do is to get to that point where they're recouping their costs.
Yes, sir.
And so that's a great thing. I do have one question.
Yes, sir.
Is Northwest Elementary the only school that's on your line?
No.
That's the only school?
That's it.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Okay. No, that's all. And by the way, we are meeting our costs.
Okay.
We are meeting our costs. Yes, sir. Okay. Yes.
The follow-up to that is that at what capacity did you say you're at?
Our plant is rated of 140,000 GPD.
Yeah. And where you? What's your usage?
Our usage is generally anywhere between 75 or 80,000 up to 110,000. So
you're pushing the upper. We're pushing the limit, right?
Well, only on normally wet days.
Yeah.
When you have a July 213, then it goes above that.
Okay.
But as I say, what we're looking for, everything's working, you know, we're trying to get funds to address any more I&I that we've got. We've addressed 80% of our I&I, the I&I that we can get rid of, which is maybe 70% of all I&I. What we're asking for is just some assistance in doing something with our the elevated storage tank for the waste storage.
One follow-up, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
At Northwest, mm-hmm. at Northwest School, do you have a meter that measures the sewer coming out, or do you bill on what the usage of water is?
We bill on water.
Okay.
We bill on water.
Since you have your own plant, you're not too concerned about if you got infiltration.
Well, yes. We are. Yeah, that's what we're trying to get rid of. But yeah. between Norwayne Elementary, it's just one shot. There's nobody else on it.
Right.
So... And it's a fairly new line, so we're not concerned about the if there was a lot of taps on it, then yes, we would be concerned.
Well, if you were sending it to another town and having to pay for that, you were probably monitoring it. Is that correct?
We probably would. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. Questions. First of all, I commend you. I remember in September when we all met that you were doing a comprehensive land use plan. You were jockeying, trying to look at 795 and the property and the availability. And I commend you for restructuring your plan to move over to 795 and use that market for automobiles, in particular commercial, whereas we need the sales tax receipts desperately in the county and moving that up. So that brings me to the question. Is that if you're at 75 to 110 GPD and you are max at 140, as you moved over into the west and southwestern sector of the 795 mm-hmm. to build in your commercial, then that's going to demand infrastructure, as you know, water and sewer. First question is, are you dealing with a sanitary district in the location over the property that you've just
at this time we're not because we haven't done this just happened. Okay. We annexed the property. Now you know I think I go back. We annexed the property in December, but you know that a couple of years ago we did annex both sides of the interstate to the north.
Yes.
So we have all four corners now.
Right. So you've rezoned it all commercial now?
Yes.
Okay, not taking it away from farmland. I want to make sure that this is an ideal spot, four corners on an interstate, especially when trying to move that traffic on down
exactly.
Interstate 40.
Exactly.
And hopefully we can have that happen in the next 10 to 15 years. We hope that will maybe yeah. speed that up somewhat, but it's going to take federal litigation to do that. But the question I have is that did you factor in fees for your sewer usage for those end users through your engineer for Pikeville to compensate for the growth?
That's in the works.
Who are you using?
Our engineer is McDavid.
Okay.
Tyndall Lewis.
Okay.
And also as a consultant we're using Utility Services, that's Scotty Wilkins. They're the ones doing the tank work, okay. both the water and the wastewater tanks that we were just talking about. So we're trying to be proactive, and I'm also, since you've mentioned it, I'm also in the early stages of trying to see if we can get to expand our plant. I doubt if we can flip it. Well, a lot of plants are built that you can take it and unfold it, so you'll have a mirror image plant on the other side to double the capacity. I don't know if we're going to do that or not, but I'd like to see 180 to 200,000 within 5 or 6 years.
moving forward, as a commissioner, trying to grow the tax base, the tax base being the property and appreciating the property instead of depreciating mm-hmm. property values, is to get that tax base and for commercial development. And when you are requesting funds from a local government, like the commissioners or state government, then those funds being citizens' tax dollars, mm-hmm. As this be the case in some funding, is that when you construct your fees and the capacities and the impact fees and so forth, mm-hmm. not to have it both ways. So structure right. your fee process moving forward to sustain your system.
Right, exactly. That's exactly right. And the problem, that a lot of smaller towns have in the South, in rural towns, is that they don't visit their fee structure as often as they should. I think fee structures should be visited at least twice every decade. Minimum. Whereas when I was consulting, I consulted several towns that hadn't changed their fee structure in decades. So, it's very important.
Thank you.
And I'm working on that.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Heading as fast as I can.
Please keep us updated.
Yes, sir.
Anyone else?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Thank you for your attendance today. Anyone else, Marshall?
Those are the requests that I had received prior to the meeting.
Okay. Thank you. We will consider all of the requests, and Mr. Mayo is kind of heading up this project, and I appreciate it, Mr. Mayo, for you taking this task on. Just try to work with the municipalities the best that you can. The pie has got to be cut in several pieces, it appears, so just do the best you can. Thank you.
Thank you.
We need to move on into the 10:30. I know we've got to jump around.
You want to do budget amendments because we have several department managers who are here.